So Lord Jesus, I thank you so much for who you are. I thank you for what you're doing. I thank you for the things that we see and the things that go unseen, God. God, I just pray that you'll be with us today and throughout this week, Lord, that you'll remind us of who you are and what you're doing, God. God, remind us of what you did upon the cross thousands of years ago, Lord, that you gave your life so that we can come to know you on a personal relationship. God, thank you so much. Thank you for the sacrifice you made, God. God, I pray that this worship today will be glorifying to you. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. like snow.
The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
By his stripes we are healed, by his nail-pierced hands we're free, by his blood we're washed clean. Now we have the victory.
Sin is broken, Jesus overcame it all. He has won our freedom, Jesus has won it all.
Hallelujah.
We are healed, by his nail-pierced hands we're free, by his blood we're washed clean, now we have the victory.
Power of sin is broken, Jesus overcame.
One our freedom, Jesus has won. is crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to wash our feet. Now at his feet we bow. The one who wore our sin and shame, now robed in
praise will rise.
I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me.
Earth as a man and dying upon a cross to take away our sins, God, for literally putting on the burden of the world on your shoulders, Jesus. God, thank you for conquering death, hell, and the grave. God, you loved us so much and you did all of that for us.
And resurrection and just who you are, God, I pray that you remind us on a daily basis of what you've done, God, the sacrifice that you made to draw us closer to you, Jesus. God, thank you so much. We worship you today.
Thank you so much for being here and worshiping with us. Stay tuned because there's still a message which I'm excited to hear. But we're going to have a couple of announcements and then we're going to get right into the Word. Love you guys.
Good morning, Open Door Church. We're so excited that you're joining us today. If you've never been a part of one of our services and you haven't had the chance to join us in person, we still want to get connected. Right now, we have set up a text number for the church where you can get connected with us. All you have to do is text the word hello, H-E-L-L-O, to the number 970-236-7444. You can use this number to text us any number of questions, and we will respond eventually. But if you do so right now, what you'll receive, if you text the word hello to that number, you'll receive a quick digital connection card. And what that'll, if you fill that out, that'll enable us to stay connected in this time where we can't gather in person. So I'd encourage you to do that. And we want to say hello. We want to get to know you, even if it's through a digital platform right now. But we're believing that God's doing amazing things. He's going to continue to move in a mighty manner, and we're going to see Jesus glorified, and we're excited about that. This evening, Sunday at 6 o'clock, we typically have live stream prayer and worship. We are taking a temporary hiatus of that this week. We want to encourage you to reflect on the resurrected Christ, reflect on Jesus as King. Spend some time with your family, and we will be back next week with our regular time of prayer and worship. This coming Tuesday, so this next Tuesday, we're going to be in our deeper projects. Our deeper projects have moved online. They're our version of Bible study and small group. kind of mashed into one, and we so love our time together in the Word of God. And so we have joined online via a Zoom meeting, which you can access by going to opendoorpagosa.com, and you can follow the link to the Deeper Project where you'll find more information there. We're excited for the opportunity to do what we're doing. Is in terms of doing services online and engaging people where they are in very uncertain times. And that's made possible by your generosity. We are a church that operates solely upon your support, and we are so grateful for the continued support that we've received in this hour. And so you can give online by going to opendoorpagosa.com. There's also a link there to set up online giving. I'd encourage you to stay faithful in tithe and offering in this uncertain season. We believe that we trust a God that provides, and we're not freaking out about money or anything like that. But I just simply want to say thank you for your continued support. May the Lord bless you as you continue to support the work of the Lord. With all that being said, we're going to jump into the Word of God this morning, and I'm so excited to do so, friends. As you know, it's Easter Sunday. It's typically the biggest day of the year. A lot of ministers will call it the Super Bowl of church, right? A lot of churches put all of their energy and a vast portion of their budget into making Easter as awesome as it can be. And what's happening in this hour and what's happening in this age, I think, is so unique, is that typically where a lot of budgets would go to make a crazy Easter extravaganza and these really over-the-top outreaches and performances. I'm not saying they're all bad, hear me out. But all of that is being stripped away in this hour. And the only thing that we still really have to rely on is the message of Christ crucified and his resurrecting power. And for me, friends, that's exciting and that's awesome, because we don't have the gimmicks, we don't have the shows, we don't have the lights that is going to somehow manipulate someone into giving their life to the Lord. What we do have is the message of hope in a risen Savior, and I'm excited about that. So we're going to jump into the Word of God, and I want you to be encouraged this morning, even if you're watching from your living room and it doesn't feel like a typical Easter Sunday, that's okay, because God is still going to move, and we're excited about that. So Father, we love you, and we thank you, and we're inviting your presence. Lord, I invite your presence here into my home right now, as many other families are gathering across our state and our city, our community, and maybe even to the ends of the earth because of the World Wide Web, Lord. But we're asking that your presence would be made known. We're inviting you, Lord, Holy Spirit, to guide us into all truth, that you would encourage us through your word, and that Jesus would be glorified. Lord, we thank you that your presence isn't confined into the walls of a building, and that your church was never about a gathering place, but it's always been about a people. And we're asking that you be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, friends, I'm so excited to get into the Word of God this morning. I don't know about you, but maybe you've been promised something from someone before. And if you have been promised something, it's probably not a far stretch for me to guess that you've had a promise that was broken. You see, when I was a young child, I was 6 or 7 years old, and my dad would take me to this little hobby store in Pueblo, Colorado. And he'd let me pick out a wooden dinosaur that we would build together. They're made out of balsa wood, and you'd punch them out, and they'd make these skeleton replicas of these dinosaurs. And I had a few of them, and I was so excited about them. And my father told me that every payday, that after he went to the bank, it was a Friday, he would stop by the little hobby store, because it was right next door to the bank, and he'd get me a different dinosaur, and we'd build them together. And I remember that happened one time, and so I was so excited for the next Friday, the next payday that would come along. And the story goes that my father forgot, I didn't get to build those dinosaurs with him like I thought we were, or like we had planned or talked about. In fact, there was even this great big one. It was a Tyrannosaurus Rex, And it stood about 3 or 4 feet tall, and it was made out of balsa wood. And I always wanted it. I still want it as an adult because it's so cool. But when that didn't pan out and we didn't wind up doing those things, I was disappointed as a kid. And that isn't to paint my father in a bad picture or anything like that. But I just remember it being heartbroken as a kid that my father didn't come through on his promise. And I want you to know, if you felt that way, maybe that correlates with maybe how you feel about God. I want to tell you right now that God is in the business of keeping the promises that he makes. And he's not like our earthly fathers that let us down. When he says something, he means it and he follows through with it. And we see that in the display of love that we see Jesus carry out on the cross for you and I. And maybe you feel like God's told you something and you haven't seen it come to fruition. I want to encourage you right now. It's not to, just because it didn't happen the way that you thought it was going to happen or in the time frame that you think it should happen, doesn't mean that God isn't about to keep his promise to you. We believe in a God that keeps his promises. I love Hebrews chapter 10, verse 32, where we get the encouragement to hold fast to the confession of our hope because the one who promised is faithful. We can hold on to this hope that we have in Jesus because he is faithful to finish what he started. I love what we read elsewhere in Scripture, that he who began a good work in you is faithful to see it to completion. We serve a God that keeps his promises. And one of the major promises that we see throughout Scripture is this promise of eternal life with God if we embrace Jesus. Right? It's John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall have everlasting life and not perish." That is something that we can hold on to. That's a promise, and that's kind of the crux of our hope, is it not? That's what we celebrate today on Resurrection Sunday, that God conquered death, that made a way for us to be with him where he is, and that isn't just a temporary benefit of serving Jesus. We are invited into eternity, eternal life with Jesus, and that is good news, friends. So with all that being said, I wish I had some kind of crazy revelation. I don't wish. I don't have a crazy kind of revelation for you today. I don't have this kind of off-the-wall gimmick to get you to be excited about Jesus in church or anything like that. What I simply have to fall back with is the Word of God, the simple fact that Jesus was crucified, that he rose again, and that we have an unshakable living hope in him that I'm excited to jump into today. So if you would turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 1, we're going to begin reading in verse 3. And I love just some of the things that we get to encounter here through this teaching, or through this passage of Scripture. I'm going to read verses 3 through 9 first, and I'm not trying to be fancy with any of this. I just want us to really hear what Scripture says, what the Apostle Peter wrote to relatively new believers. The church really has just started, but these are believers that have not seen Jesus. They didn't have the same privilege that Peter had of being a disciple and seeing these things firsthand. They're much like you and I that are living in a very real faith of loving a God that we have not seen physically, and trusting a Jesus that we've not met personally in terms of being in the flesh, but a God that we trust and whom we can't see. And that seems crazy to most of the world, but for those of us that are being saved, we understand that it is the very power of God at work in us. And so I'm going to read verse 3, beginning in chapter 1, verse 3. It says, "All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is by his great mercy that we have been born again, because God raised Jesus Christ from the dead. Now we live with great expectation, and we have a priceless inheritance, an inheritance that is kept in heaven for you, pure and undefiled, beyond the reach of change and decay. And through your faith, God is protecting you by his power until you receive this salvation, which is ready to be revealed on the last day for all to see. So be truly glad. There is wonderful joy ahead. Even though you have to endure many trials for a little while, these trials will show that your faith is genuine. It is being tested as fire tests and purifies gold. Though your faith is far more precious than mere gold. So when your faith remains strong through many trials, it will bring you much praise and glory and honor on the day when Jesus Christ is revealed to the whole world. You love him even though you have not seen him. Though you do not see him now, you trust him and you rejoice with a glorious, inexpressible joy. The reward for trusting him will be the salvation of your souls. Thank you, Jesus, for your word. Thank you for the gift that you've given us in life in Christ. The first thing that I would love to point out here is just Peter's response of gratitude. If you've joined us on a Sunday, if you've been a part of Open Door Church for any number of time, or been to any of our prayer meetings or anything like that, one of my favorite things to do is to invite the congregation, to invite you to bless the Lord, to give praise, just like what Peter's doing here. He's blessing God. He's giving praise to God out of a heart that understands what he's talking about here, that the only appropriate response to this gracious gift of life eternal that Jesus has provided with us is praising God, is blessing the Lord. And it's more than just lip service that he offers. He actually goes on and outlines things on what it looks like to be obedient children and how to live a holy life that blesses and pleases the Lord. But I love that initial response that we get out of Peter's life. The second thing that I see here is that, and this is very important that we understand, is that all of this life that we experience in Jesus, this glorious new birth as it's described here in the scripture, is made possible only by God's mercy. And this is important for us to understand because it wasn't about who we were, what we did beforehand, our moralistic righteousness, the things that we did or didn't do. It's based entirely upon Jesus and what he did. You see, he talks about mercy here, and I love describing it in this way. I kind of relate it to a speeding ticket. In fact, not too long ago, I was driving back from Durango here to Pagosa, and I'm typically driving my Jeep, which actually doesn't go very fast, believe it or not. But on this particular day, I was driving my wife's car, and it's got a little turbo in it, and it's fun to drive. And frankly, I wasn't paying attention to how fast I was going, and a state trooper pulled me over. I think I was going 80-something in a 65. I deserved a ticket. In fact, I didn't try to weasel my way out of it or flatter the cop in any sense. I simply gave him my license and went to look for the registration, which was not in the car. And this was a situation that was piling up quickly against me. But long story short, this officer showed mercy to me, told me to slow down and head on home. And I was very thankful for that, right? If any of you have ever been pulled over, you quickly do the Jesus help me, Jesus have mercy. You start pleading the blood, right? I need your help, God. But the reality of it was I deserved that ticket, right? I was speeding. I was breaking the law. I also didn't have my insurance or registration in the car. To be in my defense, it was my wife's car, and she didn't have it in the car. No, I'm just kidding. It was my fault. But I deserved a ticket. I deserved to have the book handed to me. There was no, I didn't have a good excuse just because I wasn't paying attention to how fast I was going. I definitely deserved that ticket, but the officer didn't give it to me. In the same way, we deserved the punishment that was poured out on Jesus. We deserve the separation of between us and God based upon our sin, based upon what we've done. And it would be completely just of God to do so. But because he's merciful, he does not give us what we do deserve. And instead, he poured that wrath out upon Jesus himself so that we could have life with him. And that's good news. That's what we're celebrating here today, friends. And it comes from the mercy of God. And it brings us into this, some translations will talk it, will phrase it this way, that we're born into a living hope. And I love the way that phrase is, that we have a living hope, that we're born again. We talk about being born again. It's Christianese in a sense, but Scripture very much tells us that a new birth has to transpire when we give our lives to Jesus. For us to accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior coincides with new birth, with a being born again, with new life. And frankly, the sad reality is that too many people simply look at Jesus as some kind of moralistic teacher, maybe just a good idea, or someone that they say they could get behind, and they just want to add Jesus to what they've already got going on. You know, they maybe have heard that Jesus will bless them financially, or Jesus will bless their health, or Jesus will bring comfort, or all these things, which I believe in a sense that Jesus does bless us. Jesus does give us favor. But the reality of it is, he didn't die just so we could add some bonus Jesus to our life. He died and rose again so that we could have a new life in him. And that's awesome, friends. We're invited into a new life. We're invited to be born again. And that's so important for us to understand, because Jesus never intended for us to continue living the same life we lived before we accepted him as Lord and Savior. His intent was that we would begin again, have a new birth, and live a new, different life with Jesus at the center of it all. But as we kind of continue on from there, something has to change, right? The way that you and I live right now as believers, or as those that are considered Christians or have faith that we've been born again, our life needs to reflect that. In fact, 1 Peter goes on throughout the rest of this chapter and gives us instruction on living this life here and now differently than we did before. And so that has to be a mark of a life that's changed. But the big thing that I love about this is, as we continue to read on, I want to read verses 8 and 9 again. You see, Peter here tells us that we're going to face trials, that we're going to have to endure some things in the same way that everybody else does. We're having to walk through the trials. We're having to walk through this this COVID-19 thing. We're not exempt from it in any sense, but we do know that the Lord can protect us. We do know that the Lord can be with us in this, but that doesn't exclude us from suffering. That doesn't exclude us from trial. In fact, it actually says that those trials are important for us, that our faith might be tested and proven to be true. And so I realize that's not what everybody wants to hear, but it's a valid part of the Christian faith. But immediately after that, in verse 8, it says, "You love him even though you have never seen him." And remember, Peter here is writing this, and he has walked with the Lord. He walked closely with God. And he says, "Though you do not see him now, you trust him. You trust him, and you rejoice with a glorious, inexpressible joy. The reward for trusting him will be the salvation of your souls." And I need help understanding this, friends, because a lot of my Christian brothers and sisters that have professed Jesus very vocally, I'm seeing something different transpiring through social media and in their lives right now, in which there's an uncertainty regarding all the craziness that's happening throughout the world. We realize that there's a pandemic, that there are very real problems. You know, the economy is suffering and things are changing at an unprecedented rate, and we're uncertain of the future. And I just have to ask myself, why are you freaking out? If you believe that Jesus can save your soul from hell, you better be sure that he can save you from coronavirus. I really have a hard time with people that profess Jesus and they're freaking out about everything that's going wrong in the world right now. Either we trust Jesus with our entire lives, that includes what's going on with COVID-19 right now, or we don't. I have a hard time seeing the middle ground here. If we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and that he has our soul safely in his hand, then we have no reason to worry or fret about whatever might happen. And scripture, talks clearly about us not needing to worry and be anxious about nothing. Now, I'm not saying this isn't real. I'm not saying that there isn't a real crisis at hand that we need to be engaged with and concerned about. But if you're freaking out about this COVID-19 and you're terrified and you're worried, scripture actually tells us that we're called to be filled with an inexpressible joy. We're supposed to have a joy that is unparalleled. And my prayer for believers right now in this hour, that they would learn to trust Jesus, that they would find that their trust cannot be placed in the stock market, it can't be placed in the housing market, it can't be placed in our healthcare system or our government, but that trust needs to be placed in the only one worthy to carry it, and that is Jesus himself, because he is faithful to do what he's promised. And I've put that to the test, friends, and I've seen that again and again and again, that he's come through. And so I want to encourage you, if you're shaken, if you're uncertain, I want to just ask you, where is your trust? Where is your faith? What is it placed in? Is it placed in a God who promises us a kingdom and an inheritance that's unshakable? I love that about this passage of scripture. Guess what? Heaven isn't shaken by COVID-19. It's not crumbling. It's not falling apart. It's not changing based upon what latest news report comes out. We have a certainty about the God that we serve and what he's done, and that's encouraging and exciting, my friends. But if you're feeling like you're shaken, if you're feeling like you're uncertain in this hour, and this joy that I'm talking about is escaping you, I'm going to ask that you examine where your trust is placed, because frankly, there isn't anywhere else worthy to hold your trust than in Jesus himself. And so my prayer in this hour for every believer is that they would experience this unfathomable, inexpressible joy. My prayer is that your house and your home would be filled with joy. That doesn't mean you have to put a fake smile on. That doesn't mean you're perpetually happy. But that means that you have a confident hope about who you serve, about the inheritance of heaven that you're receiving, and that your God is not shaken in the midst of this. And I believe that there is a peace and a happiness, yes, a happiness that is associated with the Spirit of God being present about his people. And so my prayer for you in this hour is that you would understand and know what inexpressible joy actually feels like. Obviously, we can't express it. We can't put it into words. There isn't a descriptor for it. In fact, this is the only place in Scripture where it's described in such a way. But I do know that a promise of the Holy Spirit taking up residence in us as believers is that we would be filled with joy. And I want that to be true about me right now. But we go on, and I love this because it doesn't stop there. You know, our hope isn't just in the fact that we get to go to heaven someday. That's real, and that's a promise of eternal life. But if you continue to read into verse 18, and I'm skipping a little bit of portion here in chapter 1, but I encourage you, read it all because it's good stuff. But in verse 18, it says, "For you know that God paid a ransom to save you from the empty life you inherited." Whoa. God paid a ransom to save you from the empty life you inherited. Friends, if you feel like your life is empty and void of meaning and purpose, I want you to stay tuned. I want you to sink into this and hear this, because there is a life that is so full that can be had in Christ. But we go on to read it. It says, "And the ransom he paid was not mere gold or silver. It was the precious blood of Christ, the sinless, spotless Lamb of God." Jesus came. He paid a ransom for us with his own blood, something far more precious than silver or gold, so that we could be with him where he is. He paid a price that we could not pay so that we could have eternal life. And friends, you need to know that eternal life doesn't just begin when we die. It's a here and now reality that we are invited into. Life with Jesus isn't just something that we have, it's not something that we just look forward to when we pass away. It's something that we can experience here and now, and I'm so encouraged by that. In fact, John 10:10 tells us that he came that we could have life and life to the full, life and life abundantly. Now, that doesn't mean we get a Bentley or that, you know, all of a sudden saying yes to Jesus is going to make money appear in our bank accounts. I'm not on that train, but what I am on is that we can have the best life that is possible by surrendering it to Jesus, and that life can continue on forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. So if you maybe were like me, and your life was empty, if it was purposeless, if you couldn't find any reason to keep going, I want to encourage you, Jesus does have a plan and a purpose for your life. Jesus can receive glory even from the mess that you've made, and he can turn it around and use it for his namesake. And I love that about our God. You see, it's not a big deal if your life is empty, if your life was pointless. He can use it and he can make it into something that's glorious. And I know for me, friends, that's a tremendous aspect of the gospel, is that he can make something out of nothing. And I love just the phrasing of the New Living here and the fact that my life was empty, or that life was empty before Jesus. You know, he paid a ransom. He paid a price for you and me. And I like to think of it this way, because you might fall into this camp. Maybe you've never said yes to Jesus. Maybe you've said yes to Jesus with some stipulations. I like to think of it like buying a car. You know, nobody goes to buy a car and pays full price for a vehicle that is supposed to be in running condition and goes to drive it off and realizes that there's no engine in it. In fact, I was at a dealership not too long ago and I was talking to this guy who bought a car off of another gentleman. He paid a price for this Subaru. It was a Subaru. It was an STI. It was one of these WRX kind of racing rally vehicles, and it was built out and had this crazy engine in it. It was supposed to be one of the fastest rally cars ever built, and crazy horsepower and stuff, all kinds of things that I'm not too well versed in, but evidently he swapped the engine out of it before he actually traded it in. So the dealership paid all this money for this car and got a car with a different engine in it, and basically they got taken, and it was the sad story. But I promise I'm going somewhere here with this. A lot of the times we do this with the Lord. You know, he pays full price. He paid a price that we can't even possibly imagine or possibly comprehend to have us and all of us. And we try to make some substitutions, or we try to withhold some things. And it's kind of like if we were a car. He paid for that title free and clear, yet what he receives is a car without a transmission, or a car without an engine. And we have these different thoughts about our lives, that we say, God, you can have my life. You paid a price for it. You can have it, but I'm holding on to control of a few of these things. You know, I'm going to keep this relationship, or I'm going to keep this addiction, and it's not going to be a big deal. But no, Jesus, you're still in control. You're still in charge. You're still my Savior. And that isn't the way this works, friends. Jesus either has all of you or he has none of you. Either we are fully his or we're not his at all. And what Jesus invites us into is not this kind of add him to our life kind of mentality. He wants all of us. And it's only in that place where he has all of us that we can experience this inexpressible joy, where we can experience this firm foundation of a life that isn't shaken based upon everything else that's going on. And so I want to invite you, if you've never made Jesus Lord and Savior of your life, there's no better time than right now. In fact, I like to say that This is the absolute best time to give your life to the Lord. The only better time to give your life to the Lord was yesterday. And that's how I've lived my life. I look back and I think, you know, there hasn't been a more opportune time for me to give my life to Jesus. I don't live in this mentality that I wish I would have had a few more years of sin and depression under my belt and do these things that I wanted to do. I'm so thankful that I gave my life to the Lord when I did. I just wish I would have done it sooner. And I've never met someone that has genuinely followed Jesus that has lived with the notion that they wish they would have lived in sin longer. That's just not the case. And so I would encourage you, today is the best day. This is going to be the best opportunity that you have to give your life to the Lord, and I want you to do so. I'm going to simply pray here, and I'm going to invite you to join with me. We want to make Jesus both Savior and Lord of our lives. He's the conquering King. He's the risen one. And we have a hope of life eternal because of that fact. And I just want you to join with me in prayer. Father, we love you. We thank you. You have saved us from a life of emptiness. And you've given us purpose. You've given us hope. And we want to make you Savior by placing our trust in you and also making you Lord by following you. We can't do this by ourselves. We need your Holy Spirit. We want to love you rightly with our whole hearts and no reservations. We bless you and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Friends, this is your first time giving your life to Jesus, or maybe you're rededicating yourself to him and you're choosing to follow Jesus, we recognize that the journey might be a little confusing. It might be a little foreign to you, and we want to help you. We believe that these next few days are some of the most pivotal when we give our lives to the Lord because to be frank, we have a real enemy, the devil, that doesn't want us. He doesn't want us to serve Jesus. And we want to equip you in every way possible to succeed in your life with Jesus. And so we have a resource that's called Journey. And all you have to do is text the word Journey, J-O-U-R-N-E-Y, to the number, let me get this right, 74574. If you text Journey to 74574, you'll get a link to download an audio resource straight to your smartphone that is very simplistic and easy to use. So they're short 10-minute segments on answering questions that you might have about new faith in Jesus or where to go from here. And we want to invite you to come and be a part of that. You can also reach out to us through Facebook or through our website or even just regular old email. We want to get connected with you. We want to stay in touch on this journey of following Jesus. And I realize that a lot of you that may have been watching this morning, you fall into the camp of saying, you know what, I love Jesus. I've walked with Jesus for years. My prayer for you today is that you would experience that inexpressible joy and that joy would overfill your house. And especially in light of a resurrected King that is alive, that we have a hope in. My prayer for all of us is that joy would overwhelm us in this season and that Jesus would receive glory as a result. We love you guys. We're looking forward to staying connected. We're going to have some music here at the end. We're going to be live in the Facebook comments. If you have any prayer requests or any needs or any questions, please reach out to us. You can personal message us. You can type them live there in Facebook. We're here. We want to be connected, and we're so grateful to spend this time together on Resurrection Sunday. We love you. We're praying for you. In Jesus' name, amen.